Welcome back to the SWN podcast. I've never said welcome back before when I've done these intros, but here we are. Season 4.5 is all systems go, and we're doing a show preview this time in season 4.5. I am joined once again by one of my favorite wrestlers in the country, and probably one of the best wrestlers in Europe right now. I'm just like cheering him up because we've got a big show to talk about, but it's absolutely true. It's Lou King Sharp. Welcome back.
Thank you very much for having me on, mate. I'm glad to be back. I must be up there with most appearances on the SWN podcast at this point.
You're getting there. This will be three. I think this will be number three. I think the only people that are beating you are Scotty Swift, because he's been on like a million times at this point, and possibly Omar Muhammad. So that's it. That's the two that are probably beating you right now. You're up there with the rest. So yeah, we're talking about Dane spotting. That's what we're here to talk about on this particular episode, and we've got some questions we'll answer. But I think the most important question we have to ask you is, how's it going?
I'm doing good, mate. Keeping well, busy just walking away trying to get these tickets gone. Me and the LKS Dojo of Excellence have been working hard with promoting and flyering and all that sort of stuff. So I just trying to get as many eyes on Dane spotting as possible, try to get as many people in the building as we can.
I've been noticing that every day I go on to Twitter, because I seem to live there now, there's always a mention, there's always a plug for Dane spotting, whether it's one of the talent on the show, whether it's someone from the LKS Dojo, whether it's yourself. There's always somebody that's putting out there that this Dane spotting show is happening. So for those that are unaware, that are listening to this and thinking, what is Dane spotting? How can you not know at this point? But I'll tell you anyway. It's Copenhagen Championship Wrestling, their first Scottish show, called Dane Spotting at Lochwinnoch Community Annex on the 29th of October. Doors open at 6:30, bell 7 p.m. So wrestling returns to Lochwinnoch. Of course, Respect ran there for a little bit, but they closed their doors earlier this year. £10 for adults, £8 for kids. Go on to Eventbrite and you'll find the tickets. There'll be a link somewhere down below, and tickets on the door as well if they haven't sold out already. So Copenhagen. Copenhagen Championship Wrestling. We talked about this last time back in March for the grunge tapings. This will be another taping for CCW. So what made you decide, right, we're bringing Dane spotting, we're bringing Copenhagen Championship Wrestling to Scotland?
So I just did a bit of Respect to closing its doors earlier on in the year. I was involved with a school there, so I was quite heavily involved with Respect, and I seen that obviously Respect had been running Lochwinnoch in the community annex for a long time. So there's obviously a market to be filled. There's a spot to be filled in Lochwinnoch, and I thought, why not CCW? Obviously there's the LKS Dojo Excellence now as well, and I wanted to provide a platform for these guys as well. So naturally, it made sense to put the two of them together, take Denmark's Wildest Night Out on tour, and I give the dojo students a chance to shine as well. But as much as it's going to be a platform for the dojo guys, they're still going to be your CCW regulars there. It's still going to be as wild as it is in Denmark. It's going to be filmed for Christiania TV, just the same as any of the other tapings or anything would be. It's going to be pretty exciting. I can confidently say that there's nothing else like it that's happened in Scotland. It's the first time, not even just a Danish promotion, it's the first time a Scandinavian promotion's came to the UK. I think it might be the first time a Scandinavian promotion's left Scandinavia itself. It's going to be a first time for Seb Silvers from Sweden. A first time for Sebastian Day from Denmark as well. So there's going to be some fresh faces from not just the dojo, but from the Scandinavian scene that a lot of Scottish fans might not have seen before. So there's definitely something a bit different on offer.
The LKS Dojo of Excellence is fair grown since the pandemic days of just being online web seminars to now you've got a space. I think it's in Aaron Girders, isn't it? You've got a space there. And now you're now the dojo is heavily involved in the show as well. So it's fair. Like I say in every interview when your name pops up. So if you sat in your little black book of contacts, you'd probably be 6 feet tall. And now here you are. And not only running a what sounds like an incredible dojo of training, because there's so many people that are just buzzing about it and talking about it, and that's always a good thing. And now that we've got the Battle Royal of Excellence as well, you've got your guys that are they're like littered through this event card as well. So it's sounds like it's going pretty well, and like you're saying, it's not bad. It's you're doing all right. Thanks.
It's not even I forgot to mention. So on top of the dojo guys and the Scandinavian guys, we've got wrestlers from nine different nations competing. So as well as those guys, we've also got Buffer from the US. You know, it made his name in Japan and in Asia. And then we've also got Guy Hawks coming in. He's from Taiwan. Both guys are obviously I met while I was over in OWE. But these guys are they're both world class. You know, can't miss kind of talents. So either you've got your future stars for the dojo. You've got your Scandinavian stars, and then we've got international wrestlers as well. So I there's a bit of something for everybody.
So an absolutely packed night. So let's just get into the card then. That's probably a good place to start. Well, both of our it seems to be a thing with my podcast, but technology is just not working. So we'll get into the show while we can, while everything still seems to be working. So the first
Oh,
match I've got for Dane Spotting. My screen went blank there, so hopefully it stayed in the recording. It is Gia Hawks. So you mentioned Gia Hawks there, from Taiwan. He's against Robbie Cardwell. This match has been kind of put out there is probably the match is going to steal the show, quite possibly. So you got Jay Hawks, like, so Taiwan, Robbie Cardwell from the area. He's round about. He's
hey, so he's from Logs.
Largs. My
From Logs,
geography is awful. I have no idea if that's
no.
close or not.
It's also a North Ayrshire area.
Ah, right. Okay. Cool. That's fine. If it's outside of Murray, I'm absolutely clueless. So yeah, this is. I'm going to guess Jay Hawks. I don't know a lot about him other than him being from Taiwan, but he's got a good look. I'm assuming he's got a bit of a high flying kind of thing going on if he's going to match up well with Robbie Cardwell, and this is going to be a show stealer. What's the thoughts of this match?
I've already said I think my sort of early prediction would be that this one's going to be the match of the night. OWE was obviously really known for the sort of acrobatic sort of style that they had, the sort of martial arts based style as well. So as much as Gaia is a high flyer, there's also a big martial arts influence in the stuff that he does as well. And there really isn't anything else like it. In the UK, the OWE they sort of marketed it as like Shaolin wrestling, and I think Gaia is a really good example of that sort of style. So it's a kind of strange hybrid of like Lucha Libre, Japanese wrestling, and like your sort of traditional Chinese martial arts. And then obviously you've got Robbie as well, who is one of the fastest rising young sort of Scottish wrestlers. He's been down at Full Tilt, so he's not just making noise in Scotland, he's making noise all over the UK. And he's doing that with a sort of very similar style of wrestling. So I think obviously Gaia's got the sort of Chinese influence, but Robbie, of course, is going to have that sort of British influence as well, that British wrestling style thrown in there. So I just think it's going to be a really sort of interesting clash of styles, but also a lot of similarities. So I think it's going to be cool.
This would be like your showcase kind of match kind of thing. This is showcasing both these styles in one kind of match. Like how back in the day you'd see GIF wrestling, you'd see Ricochet and Will Ospreay, that kind of like there's always that kind of merging of styles together, and this is the kind of match that would show off
Yeah,
both those kind of things.
I think in CCW there's always been like a big influence from the sort of Lucha Libre and Cruiserweight wrestling. And obviously when we decided to bring CCW to Scotland, I thought, right, well, I want to have at least one banging Cruiserweight match on that card. And when I looked at who the sort of the options were, that one was obvious. That's two guys that can knock it out of the park together. So if there's any match on the card that already I think you should be going out of your way to see, it's gonna be this one.
Excellent. So next up on my rank card, I'm just going through the card that I have it on the SWN website. It's probably the easiest way for me to work out what
Perfect.
matches we've got. We've got Mike Musso, of course, veteran, obviously a rival of yours in W3L. I saw your match in Elgin, the unsanctioned match, which it went a bit wild with that board off the stage. Yeah, I took a couple of goes. And so Mike Russo's there, and he's against Frank of the Cross, versus who's had many guises over the years. He's been a cowboy. He's been a he's done a bit of everything. But Frank of the Cross returns, and he's taken on Mike Musso. He did a bit of some creepy, like religious based teases before this match was announced. Two big guys, two tall guys, two guys that are probably just going to leather each other for a good little bit. But yeah, Frank of the Cross and Mike Musso, what we've got going on there.
So, I'm a sort of strong believer that a wrestling card should be like the circus, and you should have a bit of everything. And yeah, it's coincidentally that you've mentioned those matches sort of one after the other. But when booking that cruiserweight match, I'd thought, right, well, I want to go the polar opposite of that, and I want to book two big heavyweights. You know what I mean? Two big guys that, as you said, are gonna knock the piss out of each other for a bit. Mike Musso was a sort of obvious choice. As you said, I'm more than aware of what Mike Musso is capable of. I've been in the ring with him enough times myself. And I know just what he can do and how dangerous he can be. And then Frank of the Cross is obviously he's the I guess a bit of a wild card with, as you said, a man of many names, many guises. So I guess you never really know what to expect when he's on a card. As you said, there was a lot of religious based stuff that went up on the CCW social media pages. So I'm kind of assuming we're getting some sort of return to his David the Beloved sort of days. But he's obviously he's still got that Frank Cross influence in there as well. So I think we're getting a bit of a merger to all these different guises that we've seen over the years. We're kind of rolling them into one. So I'm excited for this one. I'm curious to see what version of Frank of the Cross we get, and just who Frank of the Cross is really going to be. And Mike Musso's, as you say, he's a Scottish veteran. Any sort of Scottish wrestling fan knows what to expect with Mike Musso. That's always going to be a good time. And it's always going to be a sort of hard-hitting heavyweight affair. So I definitely looking forward to seeing that one as well. It's just first two matches, and it's starting up well.
It is, and we're going through the variety straight away because the next one I've got on my list here is Ruby Roberts against Daisy Jenkins. Now we spoke about Ruby Roberts last time we did this for Grunge, and it was our match with Lexi Lux, which from all accounts and pictures I've seen was a bloodbath. Was quite the death match as kind of promised and from the build up. Going in with Daisy Jenkins, who has that kind of different style. Again, your variety is definitely the spice of life for this show because Ruby Roberts, the brawler, she'll come and fight you, but she can do a little bit of wrestling, of course, because she's a wrestler. But then Daisy Jenkins, more infused with this kind of lucha style as well. She's got this excellent like 619 hip toss kind of thing going on, arm drag, and it looks amazing. Yeah, this is gonna be an arm clash of styles. Was that your kind of thought process putting this together?
So Daisy, I'd seen at ICW. I'd seen a couple of matches there, and as you said, it was right away. It was a sort of Lucha Libre sort of style that I noticed, and that's what really stood out to me. And I was really impressed with what I seen. Ruby, not a lot of people have seen it. It's not something that she's done too often on shows. But Ruby's pretty competent in that sort of Lucha Libre style as well. So I'm kind of hoping that Daisy's almost gonna force that out of her. Obviously, we know that she's the most violent woman in Europe. She proved that with Lexi Lux in Copenhagen. But I think we may actually see a kind of a different sort of side of Ruby Roberts in this one. I think we could see a bit of a cruiserweight clash with us. And I'm buzzing for this one. I think both of these women have really broke out this year. Have been making a name for themselves. Obviously Daisy's very quickly made a name for herself on WWE Network. She's been gone around Scotland. Ruby's obviously been broken out into Scandinavia, Sweden, and Denmark. Obviously she's becoming a CCW regular now. She, as you mentioned, she'd first ever women's hardcore match in Denmark against Lexi Lux, which ended with Lexi Lux with a broken nose. So a bloodbath would have been one way to describe that. And then she made pretty quick work of Elena Morningstar as well, who's another sort of CCW regular. She's been there since the very start. But as I said, Ruby did make pretty quick work here. So Daisy's definitely going to have a work cut out for her. But also hope that Ruby's been training hard and hoping that she's been studying, because Daisy's certainly no pushover. Daisy's going to be impressing the same way she has been every other promotion that she's been in Scotland. And there's a reason both these women are on the card, and it's because they're, in my opinion, two of the best young female wrestlers in the country.
Absolutely. I mean, I had the pleasure to speak to both of them through the podcast, but Daisy Jenkins was just, I think she maybe had a couple matches on WWE Network, and it was just the fact that she started a little bit, like a bit longer in the tooth. She's a bit older when she started training, and the fact that she's still, I mean, she's still young, still younger than I am, which is pretty much most of Scottish wrestling at this point. But yeah, she's still just putting it all in there, and their matches on WWE Network that I've watched have been just excellent. She shows a lot of passion, shows a lot of skill. And then Ruby Roberts, I've watched some of her stuff in Pro 2 and what have you. So there is, if Ruby has a different side of her that she hasn't really revealed, this could be a bit, could be a very interesting kind of clash of, not even a clash of styles. If they're going to go, if she's going to throw in some lucha stuff in there, this could be quite another showcase. And I mean, we're going to say this for every match, but you're going to look forward to all of them because you wouldn't put them on the show
Yeah,
if you didn't.
I'm buzzing for the whole card. But I think this one does. It's another sort of one to keep an eye on. As you said, you're gonna see a different side of Ruby Roberts. But just in general, both of these women are brilliant, and fans and promoters alike should be keeping an eye on them.
Excellent. Right. So we'll get into some of the guys that are a bit more familiar with the CCW crowd. So we've got Sebastian Day taking on Jimmy Pierce next. Of course, Sebastian Day, someone you've no doubt had plenty of other clashes with or conversations with through Copenhagen Championship Wrestling. Jimmy Pierce, of course, is family. So is this a bit of this is going to be one you'll be watching going, is one of those days that you think if Jimmy pisses you off in the morning, you hope Sebastian maybe gets a few extra digs in him. But at the same time, you're like, it was just a match. You're like, Jimmy and Sebastian. It had to be these two. What was your thought process for this one?
So there's a bit of history with these two. So Jimmy made his CCW debut, I believe, in, I want to say, 2018. And it was Sebastian was in that match. So there was a six-man tag that involved Sebastian. So it's not the first time that these two have been in a ring together, but it's the first time that they've been against each other in a singles match. So Jimmy, obviously, sort of similar to Daisy, has been making a lot of noise around Scotland, obviously on the WWE Network through ICW. But he's not a stranger to CCW fans either. He was part of the Glasgow Boys with Logan Smith. He's going to be looking to re-establish himself in CCW. He's gone in with against Sebastian, who was the longest reigning CCW champion ever. He's going to be looking to re-establish himself and show that he can hang with a guy that's a CCW original. But Sebastian again has had to take a wee bit of time away for the ring. Only sort of recently came back this year, so he's looking to get things back off on a good foot, looking to get back into the title sort of picture or whatever else. And again, both two really talented cruiserweight wrestlers. And again, you're going to see a bit of a clash of styles. Sebastian has never wrestled in the UK. It's gonna be his first time here. As much as he might have wrestled against guys from the UK, he's never been in front of that crowd. He's never wrestled somebody who's so sort of fluent in the British style. But Jimmy, sorry, is gonna be out of his water as well. Sebastian is a Danish veteran, and he's used to wrestling guys that James has never competed against. Sebastian's used to wrestling a style that James isn't used to, or Jimmy, sorry,
Sorry,
isn't used
I like you calling him
to.
a Sunday name, like
He's not going to be used to that either. And as much as I said, it's a cruiserweight clash. Sebastian's a very hard hitting wrestler, so Jimmy, better be ready to get shit rocked.
Well, I mean, like you're saying, Sebastian Day is his first match in the UK in general. I mean, for yourself, obviously you've traveled across the world at this point, everywhere. Is there a home field advantage? Do you find that Jimmy's going to find it a bit more comfortable, even though he's up against someone who's a bit more hard hitting? Maybe he's someone who's got more years on him. But will he find it more comfortable that he's on Scottish soil, that Sebastian isn't? Have you ever found that when you went over to Scandinavia for the first time, went over to China? Do you find that first match was a bit nerve-wracking?
I do feel there is a home field advantage. Let's say I'm going to a country for the first time, not only am I thinking about my opponent and thinking about the match, I'm thinking about I want to make an impression on these promoters because I want to stay here. I want to come back here. Whereas if this guy is a regular and he's a local, then he's already got that spot there, so he doesn't need to worry about his spot. He just needs to worry about me. Whereas I've got other things playing on my mind, and that's the same if I'm in Scotland and I've got an opponent coming in from elsewhere. But I think that's one of the unique things about this show. As much as it's in Scotland, it's still CCW. So it's still Sebastian's home promotion. As much as it's a new crowd, it is still his home promotion. So I've got to wonder if that's going to play a factor in it. Jimmy's going to have that playing on his mind as well. He's going to want to re-establish himself in front of CCW management. He's going to want to make an impression, get on those Danish shows as well as the Scottish shows. So I don't think in this one anyone's going to have a too much of a home field advantage. But if I was to give it to somebody, I would give it to Jimmy. I feel like Sebastian's, as I said, this is his first time in the UK, so maybe his nerves have got to be gone at least a wee bit. But at the same time, he's no stranger to international competition, so I'm sure he's still going to knock it out of the park.
Yeah, you're saying that about the, of course, thinking about promoters and that. And when you've got a card like this, when it's got, of course, Frank Cross for Big Massive Wrestling, you've got Mike Musso, who's mentioned W3L, heavily influenced W3L. There's opportunity there for these guys, and then you've got guys from other promotions that are gonna that we're gonna speak about that may be able to bend a promoter's ear, going, oh, I saw this guy, I saw Sebastian Day have this incredible match. I think we should maybe pop them up to. Got a couple of guys from Target. You've got Target. Maybe Target will book them off the back of it. It's like you're saying, both have a home field, so to speak. But obviously, there's opportunity afoot if they perform well in front of these guys that have got promotions of their own. So it's yeah, definitely. There's a lot more going into that than you'd possibly think. But there's got a lot of bit mind games either way. Going, you've got to perform
Yeah.
well so you can possibly come back. And yeah, it's just a fascinating contest. And again, could be any kind of style. What I'm getting from some of these matches, these guys are all well versed on anything. If they want to do a bit of cruiserweight, want to do a bit of technical, there's the opportunity for seeing a bit of everything. In the first, was it four matches we spoke about? You get just about any style you could imagine in those four matches
Absolutely.
themselves. Right, let's take an absolute left turn, because we've got your match next on my list here. It is the Choose Life match. It's Glasgow Grindhouse, Looking Sharp and Kreiger against Legends Never Die, Sammy Sparks and Fulton King. We do have a question about it. It is from Gaz Williams, who we'll speak about in a second. The Rad Lad Gaz Williams, he asked, what are the rules in Choose Life match?
So the easiest way of putting it is a choose life match is is your traditional I quit match. Basically, our opponents will have the option to face the grindhouse, or they can pussy out and they can choose life. So they can face the violence and they can face the grindhouse, or they have the option to choose life. Or should they be able to muster the strength, they can try and make us choose life. But of course, I'm going to be biased, but I don't see it happening.
So this is probably going to be your wild card of the whole show then. This is the one that possibly puts an 18 tag on that, or a parental guidance possibly. We know what the Glasgow Grindhouse are all about, really. Between when whether it's the Ronin, whether it's well up northeast, you're proper mental. You're the dancing guys. But once you exit the northeast, you become these two just killers, it seems, in the I don't know what Aberdeen does to you. If you sniff the granite, sniff the sea, and you become
vibe
must be. But I've seen these guys, Legends Never Die. I haven't seen them team up yet, but I've been watching a lot of Target Wrestling recently, and Sammy Sparks, he's really come a long way since I first match I saw him was like back in March, I think, their 9th anniversary. And every show it gets a little bit wilder, it gets a little bit crazier. I think there was a match he had with against the Asylum and Tim Strange, and he was just flying everywhere. He was no regard for his body, it seemed to be. So he's definitely well suited for this. And Fulton King has become one of my favorites through Target. It's just I don't know what it is about him. It oozes this kind of natural charisma, and it's much like when I see yourselves see you see yourself and Krieger. When I saw you guys wrestle for the first time, it's like there's just something natural about these guys that you just can't help but like enjoy watching, because it looks like they're just so heavily into it. I know your opponents, and there's going to be some sort of respect in that point until first the bell rings and they decide if they want to choose fight facing the grindhouse. But was there a reason why you picked well why you kind of threw why you chose Sammy Sparks and Fulton King to be put into this match?
So I could pretty happily say that they're two of the hardest working students at the LKS Dojo. So they travel up every week from Carlisle, or from the sort of borders, to train in Glasgow. So just purely on that alone is already a lot more effort than a lot of folk are willing to make. And they're both, as you said, they're both just very talented. Both as singles wrestlers and as this tag team that they've recently formed. They approached me as a coach, and they said that they wanted to be a tag team. They wanted to start getting out there, and they wanted to establish themselves as as a real tag team, like a career tag team. So if they want to do that, I'm going to throw them in the deep end. I'm going to give them a blessing and a curse. So they can get in there with a CCW regular. They can get in there with a Glasgow Grindhouse and get some eyes on them. Work with a coach, work with Krieger, who also comes in, helps with the coaching. But as I said, it's a blessing and a curse. It's at CCW. When I go to CCW, even if it's in Loch Winnock instead of Copenhagen, it's getting wild. So it's no, I don't think it will quite put an 18 on the show, but definitely some parental guidance. Anytime I go to CCW, I go to make a statement. I've bled out in CCW rings. I've taped my heat back together. I've thrown fire. So I if it's a Copenhagen Championship wrestling show, if it's on Christiania TV, then I it's gonna get mental. Throw in the fact that I'm now in there with Krieger. Krieger's much like what we mentioned before, Krieger's looking to make a statement, looking to bring Glasgow Grindhouse International, take it to Copenhagen, take it all out of the world, really. So Sammy Sparks and Fulton King, as much as they've got a good opportunity in front of them, they've got hell to go through first to get there. But there is a reason that they've been picked to be in that position. As I said, I'm very confident in both of them. I think they're going to choose life, but I don't think they'll die easy. I wouldn't have picked an easy opponent. I want to put on a show. I want somebody that the legends, as the tag team says, legends never die. I want somebody that's gonna get 110%. So I want somebody, as you said, Sammy Sparks has no regard for his body. When neither do I. Krieger is, in my opinion, my biased opinion, one of the best heavyweight wrestlers in Europe. Fulton King's one of the best upcoming heavyweight wrestlers in this country. So it's a natural fit. If they want to establish themselves as a tag team, then Dane Sporting is the place to do it, and I hope they do.
So, I mean, you put together this card. Was it important for yourself to at least make like to put you on the show? Like, there's a million things that you could be thinking about that day, which may fall into Legends Never Die's favor. But there were a million things you would think about. Was it just a case of going, right, if I'm putting on the show, I'm still gonna need like a good whatever 20 minutes, half an hour to just maybe get some of that pent up pressure off, and know what I'm doing there. I know I'm wrestling. I could do that. Whether the promoting side can just take a little back seat for a moment, just give you a break more than anything.
So I just honestly I'd always wanted to get involved with running shows and stuff. And I'd always said that I wouldn't have booked myself. Obviously for it wasn't the sort of standard situation. I never just sort of started running my own shows. I bought into an already established promotion. So when I did that, I just obviously I didn't want to stop working for CCW. It was my one of my favorite places to work. So I thought I can try and lead from the front, I guess. Get involved in the ring as well. And it's easy to ask people to go out and give 110%, and fucking go wild. But I'll go out and, as I said, I'll lead for the front. I'll show them just how wild that I'm gonna be, how wild CCW wants to be, and I'll show people what I think we need to do to take it to the next level. And
Absolutely.
I'm happy I get to do that with a couple of my students and my best mate as well.
That's it. I mean, like you're saying, it's easy for you just to go, right, this is you're in this match, go all out, and they could just be sitting there going, oh, you're going to sit in your arse the whole time and watch this one. But like you're saying, you're going to lead from the front and go, right, CCW is going to be wild. I'm going to be just as wild. Let's do this. Yeah, I'm noticing the Blood Tourist is well at home at CCW. It's like we were saying, up in Aberdeen, your proper mental, the dancing guys with still with the skinny jeans, which I was amazed. I loved that was what you came out with in Aberdeen Anarchy, because I was like, are we going to get Blood Tourists? Are we going to get the Ronin? We're going to get Glasgow Grindhouse? But no. As soon as Liberty X hit, I was like, oh yes, this is peace. This is home. But yes, like I say, outside of Aberdeen, you're Blood Tourist. You've got just all these kind of guises, much like Frank of the Cross has as well. It's just your man of many talents. What I will say in the future, though, please don't get rid of the beard again, because that was when I saw the pictures when you with your glorious mullet and the no beard. I was like, no, this is very off-putting for me. I don't get it.
I've made a lot of people uncomfortable.
But I mean, it's your prerogative. It's your face at the end of the day. But I was like going, no, because when you get rid of the beard, you look 16 again. And that's when I started watching you wrestling, and I thought, I don't need that needless attack on my age. I've seen you so
It's
young.
a Discovery Wrestling time machine.
Oh, Alan spoke to me about this time machine that he's looking to boot up next year. And if we do see a little bit of fix up Luke Sharp again, I'll be okay with it. I'll be okay with the beard going just for that, for the one night only.
The time machine would be very worth it.
Just the pure the thought of it, because I've spoken to the guys in the past, of course, like Aspen Faith, and of course he started as a hippie horror with all this very colorful gear, and it's very much against what he wears now. And There's so many guys that I've seen their first promos, Jack Jester being one of my favorites, because it just does not look like Jack Jester now, with the old, blue and white fluffy gear and all that kind of stuff. And I hopefully Alan is able to get that time machine going, because I am all into to seeing it in action. But this isn't about Discovery. This is about Dane spotting Copenhagen Championship Wrestling. So we'll get back on track a little bit. So we've got the we'll go for the LKS Dojo of Excellent Battle Royal of Excellence next. That's a mouthful and a half there. I've got, right, hang on, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. I've got 8 entrants from my list here. So I don't know if there's going to be some appearances from others. I assume there will be, or there'll be some appearances from other people on the show. But I'll tell you the list I've got for this match. So the LKS Dojo of Excellence Battle Royal of Excellence entrants. And take a breath. The Killer from Manila, Mendoza. Golden Boy, Charlie Anderson. Inhuman, Zero. The Harbinger, Benny. The Rad Lad, Gaz Williams. Roderick Jones from Pontypandy. I didn't know if he had a actual gimmick thing name to go with him. I thought it was Easy Target, but I thought that was mean. Yeah, Jan Fada, the Slavic One, and Inevitable Stone Malone. That's quite a mix of not only styles and talent, but also nationalities in that Dojo of Excellence. So putting this together again, was it just checking your students, going, right, these guys are gonna, this is our opportunity to make an impact, get onto TV, get onto CCW. Was there any particular thoughts? Was there anyone approached you particularly that were going, I want in this match?
So obviously, what as you can tell for the name, originally the idea was just to have a match where I can get as many of the dojo guys an opportunity to shine as possible. And obviously with it being a battle royal, I realized I can sort of go as wild as I like with the numbers. So I thought let's get some representation for elsewhere in there as well. Because obviously there's been a lot of places have been a big help to me. So we've got Jan Farah, who's primarily training with GPWA, and Iron Girders, and then Gaz Williams, or Gash Williams. He is training with Source, and then Roderick Jones is coming from W3L. So as well as the sort of the best of the dojo, we've also, in my opinion, got some of the best from other schools as well. And I it would just be a really good showcase of just young talent. But at the same time, it is an open door, much like the LKS Dojo of Excellence has an open door policy. So does the Battle Royal of Excellence. So we could see more folks showing up. But I with the guys that are in there at the moment, it's looking to be a good showcase of some young talent. I'm really looking forward to it. I think there's going to be a few folk that are really going to stand out. I think Benny, as much as I'm saying young talent, Benny has been around for a long time, so it's Zero. And I think these guys will really be looking to make a name for themselves on a sort of bigger scale as well. This is a chance for these guys to show off a bit, what they can do to some European promoters. Obviously, it's gonna, as I said, gonna be on Danish TV and stuff, so it's a chance for them to try and get into that sort of market, I guess. Benny recently debuted in SWS, in Sweden, which is they work pretty closely with CCW, so he's got a bit of familiarity with the Scandinavian scene, and then obviously Zero's another guy who's been on WWE Network and been going up and down the UK. So I the sort of newer guys have got their work cut out for them already. Just with Benny and Zero, of course. Stone Malone is a former Source champion,
Still
and
is the Source champion, I think.
he's still is a Source champion,
Yeah.
and he's a former Pro 2 interpromotional champion as well.
Yep.
So I even though I'm saying young wrestlers, there's a bit of talent in there. There's some name value to these guys as well. I'm looking forward to seeing Mendoza from the Philippines. Obviously, I just say the internationality. We've got Jan Farah from the Czech Republic, and Roderick Jones is Wales' own. So I it's that's going to be an exciting one with a bit of representation for everywhere.
I've seen, I'm going to absolutely butcher remembering the name, but it was Victor Industries. Am I right in remembering that in CCW?
EV Entertainment, and it's that's Victor Victorious is
That's it.
the leader of that.
I was seeing you put out a tweet about maybe bringing something to that, and you put out in a quote tweet, Sorcerer Kurt. Now, you told me about this guy last time, and you sent me a video of the guy who's just an enigma of his own being. Is there a possibility we're going to see some more CCW regulars maybe in this LJS Dojo of Excellence, or is it, or is I mean, anything can happen.
So it's anything can happen. I don't think Victor Victorious is going to be getting involved in the match himself. He's a bit of a chicken shit. So yeah, getting involved directly isn't really his kind of style. But he is the owner of CCW. EV Entertainment are the sort of the overall owners of the company. So if he's looking to make some changes to the match, I think it's. There's potential for it to be a big opportunity for some of the guys in there. I don't think it's very in character of them to do good. But I think there's potential for be something put on the line at least. But in terms of people showing up, I don't know who exactly, but I've heard murmurings that there's a Scottish wrestling mainstay that's looking to get on the card, and obviously with the dojo being an open door policy, that would be their best bet.
I mean, we're going to see some amazing matches anyway, but that's the one that could be full of surprises then. I do, I mean, not that it's going to compare, but it reminds me, I don't remember TNA when Kevin Nash did his X Division Invitational, and it was the big battle royal, and it was just like nuts. There was loads of X Division guys, and Bob Backlund would maybe show up, or D-Ray 3000. So I'm expecting it's going to be a lot of guys looking for opportunity, and then maybe some guys are just looking just to get a name on the card kind of thing, and just provide some entertainment. So that's one. I love a battle royal anyway, so it's always one I'm going to have an eye on to hopefully see.
Oh, I'm the same. There was any time I've got influence on a card, you better believe that there's going to be a battle royal in there.
Good, good. I mean, when I'm doing like fantasy match cards, I'm like, there's always a battle royal because I'm like, I want to have everyone on this. But I don't know how. Oh well, 30-man battle royal at the end. There we go. That's how it's everyone else. If you don't think you're named on it, you're in the battle royal. That's why. So on to the triple threat then. Before we get into the championship main event, we've got Uno Raw, the big strong man himself, versus Colton Davis, the undefeated, apparently, against the Big Buffa, from well from the US. Obviously wrestled across the world, along the world,
Yeah.
across the world. I've seen he put up a clip. He was in combat, was it Combat Zone Wrestling? Am I right in thinking that he was
Yeah,
back in the day? A bit of
he
Chikara
was
as well.
in TJW. He was in Chikara as well. He done a load of pretty much any of the sort of big indies from like the sort of early to mid 2000s. There's a good chance that he at least had a couple of matches in there. But his sort of main ones were CZW and Chikara. Him and his brother held the NWA tag titles at one point as well. His sort of main work though came from Asia. As I said, I met him at OWE, but previous to that, he was in Japan where he was working for FMW. He worked for mainly for Zero One, and there was sort of various other sort of indie promotions and stuff as well. But yeah, former Zero One champion. And I a 20 plus year veteran, he's wrestled all over the world. Telling me the other day about when he wrestled in Nepal, he was presented with a medal from the president. He's a prime minister, whatever they have. He's done a bit of everything. He's had an absolutely mental career. If you go on his Twitter, a lot of people always talk about the flags in my Twitter bio. Like, he puts mine to shame. He's been everywhere. So he's been all over Asia, made a name for himself at first in obviously North America. So he's also done some stuff in Canada and Mexico as well. So he's really, really well versed in a load of different styles. Obviously there's the sort of American aspect to the sort of showmanship, but there's also a very hard hitting sort of Japanese aspect that as well as, he, as I say, he spent a lot of time in Mexico, and I'd certainly say there's a big Lucha Libre sort of influence to that as well, which obviously would have been a benefit to him while we were in OWE. But he's, as I say, that I can't miss wrestler. Had a brilliant match with Martin Kirby at the Grado's Big Family Wrestling Bash show in the Pavilion. Had a good match for Shreddy at Target Wrestling as well. He's been going up and down the UK. Not even just the UK, he was in Scandinavia recently, wrestled a former CCW talent, he wrestled Carlos Zamora in Sweden. He's even got a wee bit of familiarity already with the sort of Scandinavian aspect of things. So he's a very experienced wrestler.
So this is a bit different then from the likes of, like we were saying about Sebastian Day. He's coming in quite fresh, brand new to Scotland, even though CCW is his home. Buffa's came over to the UK. He's acclimatized himself. He's wrestled in front of family crowds, wrestled in front of a bit more grown up crowds. He's had opponents. He's traveled. He's definitely got, and he's got 20 years experience, which is probably about at least 15 more than his opponents. Although Ewan's been around for a good while, so yeah, a little bit of a different. Buffa's going to come in quite confident. He's a big vibrant character as well with the big boombox, so he's definitely going to be the one that these two guys will be looking to either take down and make a name for themselves, or at least very much try to get one over on them. So we've got Colton Davis as well, of course, from primarily Source, if I remember rightly. So he's a big guy. He's like 6 foot. Or something like that. He's huge.
I believe he's 6'6", but he's got to be up there with what at least one of the sort of tallest wrestlers in Scotland, and in my opinion, he's one of the most talented, despite his sort of lack of exposure so far. I think as much as obviously as we said, Buffa is a very experienced wrestler, I think Colton's a guy that can give it to him. What he lacks in experience, he makes up for with talent, and size as well. Being that size comes with having a lot of sort of natural power that a lot of people won't have. He's been going up and down the UK. He's been at Full Tilt recently in Newcastle in England. He's working a few other sort of promotions in Northeast England. Another one who recently debuted in Sweden, competed for the UEWA Cruiserweight title against myself in a four-way contest. So I know myself what he can do. He's no stranger, obviously, as I just said, to multi-man matches. He's had that experience working a sort of Scandinavian style in a multi-man match. So I guess there's a potentially a slight advantage to him with that as well. But Colton is certainly one to watch on the UK scene. I think he's one to watch on the UK scene now because in a few years he's going to be one that you'll be watching on your telly.
Well, I'm due to, because I haven't really put an announcement about it, and I will once I've actually finished recording. But the Sharp Dojo series returns, and Colton Davis is finally going to be the first guest. We discussed this back in August, I think, of bringing this back, and due to of course a small child just absolutely overtaking all my plans and everything, it's just been put off and put off. But I'm finally speaking to Colton Davis next week, so we'll get the Sharp Dojo series back up and running.
Brilliant.
Hopefully once a month, although we're running out of year. But hopefully by next year we'll get a proper league up and running again. So I'll get to catch up with Colton Davis. Like last time I spoke to him, we didn't have a lot to speak about because he didn't have a lot of matches at that point. And I think it's one of those few episodes I had to edit because my mother-in-law turned up halfway through it, and she started shouting from me downstairs. And I was like, this is just the worst timing of everything. But so I'm looking forward to catching up with him. But we've mentioned those two guys. We can't not mention the big strong man himself, you know, Raw, who is wrestling, seems to be every day. By looking on social media, he's doing stuff with Mega Slam. He's Pro 2. He's just working his big strong arse off, it seems, around the country. So, yeah, Ewan, was he just a guy that it was no brainer that he was going to be in the show, or was he already tapping you for a spot?
No, so he was a no-brainer. He was so he's coming in. He's not making his CCW debut. He made that back at Sicker Than Your Average, where he took on Victor Volt. He wrestled him. In fact, that was a really good match actually. So CCW fans will be familiar with a big strong man. And as you said, he's been working his ass off. He's working almost non-stop with Mega Slam, as you said, pretty much every day. If not every day, and whenever he's not working with Mega Slam, he's filling that with other bookings. He's very, very entertaining. In my opinion, the most entertaining sort of young wrestler coming through just now. He's trained under me for a long time. He trained with me back at Respect before before they shut down, before the dojo, and he trained with me at a different school previous to that as well. So I'm sort of very aware of his talents, which is one of the reasons that made him a no-brainer. I've always sort of been aware of what he's capable of. And because of that, I know that as much as everybody sees the big strong part online and sees that character, people forget just how much this guy can go. This guy studied a lot of judo and that sort of thing, and he's a very talented wrestler. As much as he's an entertainer, if you piss him off, that's a guy that can drop a gear, and when he does, people are in trouble. This is a big strong heavyweight clash, big strong triple threat. I think very very different backgrounds. For each of the guys, but very similar styles. Three sort of powerhouse wrestlers, but each do have their own sort of advantages as well. I couldn't honestly pick a winner for that one. I really think that could just go either way. As I said, Colton and Ewan, both very very talented young guys. It would be daft to bet against them. They've been making a lot of noise all over the country, but at the same time, you just can't disregard a guy who's been competing for 20 plus years at such a high level. Even if they do manage to pick up the win against Buffer, they're gonna have to fucking work for it, because that's a guy who's gonna make them. That's a guy who's not gonna give it up easy. He's no came to Scotland on holiday. He's came here to work. And he's came here to, continue to cement himself as honestly one of the absolute best wrestlers in the world. If you want to talk about an all-rounder, this guy can do everything. They're really gonna have to work their asses off. But if those two boys I'm confident it could be them.
Just before we go on to the main event, then just my favorite story about Raw when again post, previous chat. I don't think it was with him actually. I think it was with Mayhem Brooks. Of course, he's big into his MMA and all that kind of stuff. And the story was he poked and prodded at the bear, at the big strong man, and Ewan just absolutely threw him. So I mean, he doesn't. You look at Raw, and like you're saying, he could be this entertainment. It could be Grado Lite or anything like that. It could be anything he needs to be, but if he needs to, he will bar you. So it is literally just watching for that gear. So the main event, then. So we've got the CCW Championship. We've got Nitro Green, who I've spoke to before in the Sharp Dojo series, against Seb Silvers, who Am I right thinking it's another one that's making a debut in Scotland, not for CCW, but
Yeah,
for in Scotland in
and
general,
in the UK.
in the UK? So Nitro Green has wrestled in the UK before. He did stuff at Pro 2. He did stuff at Respect as well before they closed up. So
Yeah,
he's
did
well
All
tuned.
Star Wrestling as well, previous to that. So he's pretty familiar with the UK scene. Obviously he's spent enough time in the ring against myself, and I'm pretty sure even at this point he's even wrestled Craig a good few times. So he's definitely used to working guys from this scene. But it's that's not what he's up against. He's up against Seb Silvers from Sweden. He's from Malmö. He, in my opinion, is the best young wrestler in Europe. I think in a number of years, this guy is going to be competing at a sort of very high level. Say 5 years from now, he's gonna be competing at a high level. He's very, very talented. And he's not had a lot of matches. I wouldn't want to say the number exactly because I honestly don't know. But I know when I first seen him, he'd only had four. And that wasn't all that long ago. He's definitely not had that many matches. In the sort of grand scheme of things, he's still definitely an up-and-coming wrestler, but he's definitely going places at the same time. Nitro is a CCW mainstay. He's the leader of Los Luchas del Muerte. I could talk forever about my own sort of dealings with Nitro, my own feud with Nitro. But to be unbiased about it, and to look at it objectively, he's a very, very talented individual. Very dangerous individual as well. People might have been familiar with what they've seen on All Star or at Pro 2, stuff like that, where was perhaps more a traditional luchador. But when Nitro is in Denmark, that's Nitro's scene. That's where he's the guy. And he's very much looking to hang on to that reputation as the sort of the top guy, the guy to beat in Denmark. And that CCW title is, I guess, the sort of crown to that. That's the proof in the pudding that he's the top guy and that he's the number one. Seb Silvers, I do think Seb Silvers could be the guy to beat him. I honestly think that at Dane's bottom we could see a title change. He's competed against some of the best wrestlers in Europe. He's been already competing at a pretty high level, competing at a championship level across Scandinavia. As we've mentioned, there's always the sort of new town jitters, I guess. But he's already shown across Sweden and Denmark at least. That he can, he doesn't crack under the pressure. He's the Swedish supernova is more than just a name. You know what I mean? He's full of fire, and that doesn't seem like it's burning out anytime soon. But I would never underestimate Nitro. As I said, he is very dangerous. He doesn't have the luchas with him this time. As far as I know, it's just Nitro coming this time. So potentially, that's going to be playing on his mind. Potentially got to be playing on his mind that he's in front of Luke King Sharp's home crowd. After the way that he's acted in the past. I think there's a lot of factors that might be playing on Nitro's mind. But similar to Seb, he's not a guy that's known to crack under pressure. He's competed against names all over the world. Much like you're saying about myself, wrestling all over the world, Nitro has had a careers that sort of paralleled each other's. When I went to places I did, he started going out to America. He went to Africa and wrestled in Morocco. He wrestled in Israel. This is a guy that's wrestled in some pretty mental places. So Seb's certainly gonna have his work cut out for him, but the real winners are gonna be the audience, because it's the reason that this match is a main event is because it's a showcase of Scandinavian wrestling. We've got a guy from Sweden and we've got a guy from Denmark. And yeah, a guy sort of, I guess, representing the home scenes on an international stage. Neither of them have a home field advantage. Both of them, as I said, re representing their home countries in front of a new audience, and looking to make as much noise as possible. As much as Naito can be very selfish, I do think he cares about the company that he's at the front of. And he realizes that it's of benefit to him for CCW to blow up and be in front of as many people as possible. So I think he's still gonna go out there and he's gonna put on a show. Seb Silvers always does. Every time he gets in the ring, he puts on a show. And yeah, there's as I said, there's a reason this one is gonna be the main event. It's gonna be everything that CCW is all about. It's Scandi Graps, as they call it. It's a Scandi Graps showcase. Two guys that, as we said, Nitro has been here before, but the fans still probably not too familiar with them. Two guys that you've probably not seen before. You're certainly not too familiar with, and they're going to be working a style that you might not be too familiar with. But they're definitely going to be very entertaining. And yeah, they're de definitely going be putting all out there.
Excellent. So that's the full lineup. So I'll go through the information again. We'll get your prediction for what your match tonight is going to be after I've run through the card. And then I've got 10 minutes to get some more of the questions that I've got through Twitter, and then we'll wrap up and you can go back to putting the final touches to the show. So Copenhagen Championship Wrestling, Dane Spotting, 29th of October at Loch Winnick Community Annex. Doors 6:30, bell 7 p.m. Tickets on the door or on Eventbrite. There'll be links to follow everywhere, somewhere in this video or audio. You can check out on Facebook, CPH Wrestling on Facebook, and it's at CPH Wrestling 1 on Twitter. £10 for adults, £8 for kids. So full lineup. I've got Gia Hawks versus Robbie Cardwell, Frank of the Cross versus Mike Musso, Ruby Roberts versus Daisy Jenkins, Sebastian Day versus Jimmy Pierce. The Choose Life match, Glasgow Grindhouse, that's Looking Sharp and Tiger versus Legends Never Die, Sammy Sparks and Fool and King. You may tell by the rapidness of this. I used to do radio. LKS Dojo of Excellence, Battle Royal of Excellence, that have got so many people in it that it will take more time for me to read them than to do the rest of this. So Triple Threat, UNORAW versus Colin Davis versus Buffa, and the main event, CCW Championship, Nitro Green versus Seb Silvers. We'll take out that Choose Life match for a moment. What's your match of the night?
I'm going for Guy Hawks and Rob Cardwell.
Excellent. So
I think we'll knock out of the park.
We've got a couple more questions, and we've got three questions, and then we'll wrap up for the day. The Masked Embroiderer, of course, who provides Looking Sharp with a lot of his snazzy patches on his dungarees, asking where can we see it if we sadly can't attend. So I know it's going to be on Danish TV. Is there going to be a UK outlet at all?
So there will be a UK outlet, which is sort of yet to be announced. That will be announced soon. It'll be on Christiania TV in Denmark, which I believe you can access if you've got a VPN. You can access it if you sort of set it to Denmark. You can access that online, as well as obviously on sort of TV over there. But yeah, there will be a UK outlet announced soon. I guess probably irrelevant to most people watching this, but just sort of while we're on the topic, I guess we recently announced on Reddit that we are going to be streaming on Bilibili, which is a Chinese streaming service essentially. So it's kind of like Chinese kind of YouTube. So yeah, we're going to be streaming on that, and again, just trying to get as many different eyes on CCW as possible and expand internationally, not just with a show in Scotland, but in terms of what fans are able to see us.
An excellent sounding website there. So we've got two questions from Ruby Roberts then to wrap up. So we'll go with Death match, and you get to pick the opponent, Mario or Luigi. And yes, all Mario Kart weapons are legal.
I'm gonna go Luigi, and I don't think he's even gonna need a weapon. I think it's just years of pent-up bitterness. You know what I mean? He's been constantly taking a back seat, so I think he can take down Mario with his bare hands.
For you though, who would you pick? So it'd be Mario, then you'd go maybe Luigi's a bit too of a wild card for you to face. Is Mario
Oh,
your
sorry,
pick?
can you face one? I thought you said who would win.
I like your thinking though. I like it. But yeah, so who would you pick to face?
So I would also still pick Luigi. So, because he's not going to take out that aggression on me. If he's in there with Mario, then you know what I mean, that he's gonna, you know what I mean, he's gonna black out. Mario's done. If he's in there with me, then obviously he's still a bit of a bitch, because there's a reason he's been taking a back seat, because he's a bit of a bitch. So I'll take Luigi.
Fine. Love it. I love it. Anytime we seem to have a chat on these things, there's something comes up, and that might be the question that ends up being put into most episodes going forward. Because I've had to retire the two sheep, one cow. It's been sorted. There's a video and everything. A sheep beating a cow. It's done. We've confirmed it. Final question then. If you could get the chance to jump into and experience any film, what would it be?
That's a good one. Like, naturally, I'm thinking of, like, my favorite films, but I definitely wouldn't want to live in a Tarantino film. You know, that would be terrible. I don't know, that's really hard. It's surely, because it's got to be something. If I'm going to need to live there, it's going to need to be something good. Willy Wonka and the Chocolate Factory. I'll go there.
All right, a bit sinister, but okay, cool. That's is
What's
well,
sinister?
obviously,
Well, yeah,
is
everyone's
Charlie
in there.
running it now? Is Charlie running the factory? Spoilers for
Well,
Charlie and Chocolate Factory.
we would assume so.
Yeah.
Do you know what? I tell you where I'd go. I'd go into the wrestler, the film The Wrestler,
Ah, there
and
you
find
go.
out if he died. I'd find out, I'd come back and let us all know. It's all right, he was fine, he hit the elbow drop.
Love it, love it. Again, spoilers for The Wrestler, but watch The Wrestler.
It's
It's
been
amazing.
long enough, I've not seen it by now.
I know, was it
You asked me.
2008? You have to watch it anyway, from Marissa Tomei in itself. Anyway, right, so that's it. Dane spotting wrapped up. We've got it on Saturday. Can't wait to see the results. I unfortunately won't be there, but I'll be keeping an eye on the old Twitter machine, hopefully for some pictures and some clips. But no, thank you for joining me to
Thank you
preview this
very much
show, and hopefully we'll get you back on next year, and we'll have a proper catch up, and whatever madness other people can ask questions for you
for
about films and the like. But no, can't wait for the show. Can't wait to hear more about it. And thank you for joining me.
No, thank you very much, man. I appreciate it. And yeah, let's do it. I look forward to coming back on.